Good evening, everybody. Let's all stand. Let's worship the Lord.
Of all that you've done. shaping of my life. All I am, I surrender. Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. I need you to soften my heart. Spirit strong in me, my flesh may fail, but my God, you never will. I may be weak, but your spirit strong in me, my flesh may fail, but my God, you never will. Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good, your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. Give me faith, trust what you say. Strong in me, my flesh may fail, but my God, you never will. And I may be weak, but your spirit strong in me, my flesh may fail, but my God, you never will.
As we continue to worship the Lord this evening, the ushers are going to come forward to receive this morning's offerings. I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His
his body bound and drenched in tears. They laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still in
you, Lord. We worship you. Lord, we thank you for, again, what you have done for us, Lord. You have called us out of darkness, Lord. You have placed our feet upon solid ground, upon the rock. And Lord, thank you for establishing our lives. And Lord, as we meet every week like this, Lord, we know that, Lord, you're further establishing us, further anchoring us in you. And Lord, that's why we're here tonight. We're here to grow in our faith and in our walk with you. And so, Lord, take our hearts that have been directed to you. And Lord, as we open your word tonight and as we discuss your word, Lord, may more of your word get into our hearts. And Lord, we want to just be closer to you. We love you, Lord. Thank you for this time. Ask you to bless this time in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Why don't you turn and greet someone next to you, then have a seat.
On Sunday, March 18th at 5 p.m., Calvary La Habra will hold a private screening of the new film, I Can Only Imagine. The movie will play at Regal La Habra and doors will open at 4:30 p.m. Tickets are $10 and can be purchased online or at the Resource Center.
So I wrote this song for my dad.
Hello, Calvary La Habra. This is Nazareno and Carlos, and we'd like to extend an invitation to the Monday and Tuesday Passion Week.
We both signed up and opened up our homes during Easter, and we'd like you to come and fellowship with us, have some fun, have some good food. You know, Calvary La Habra is great with food, and together we can find out what happened on Monday and Tuesday of that week.
We'd like you to sign up either in the Resource Center or online. There's 13 other homes, and look forward to having you and having some time together during Passion Week.
Don't miss out.
Hello, Calvary La Habra. We're having a barbecue fundraiser Sunday, March 11th. We're going to make meals to go, and we're fundraising for this summer's high school internship. The meals will be $40 each and packaged for a family of four. The meals will include one rack of ribs, our signature barbecue baked beans, macaroni salad, coleslaw, and biscuits. If you would like the meal, you need to order by today. You can order online or at the Resource Center.
Good evening. Well, rumor has it we're going to fill up our sanctuary with water for VBS. Wait, you think we can't do that? We've done it twice. It's a joke. We had a flood here twice, and it filled up our sanctuary with, we were skimboarding in here, but no ships. Isn't it great to be here? It's good to be here. So, you know, John the Beloved, loved the Lord, loved the body of Christ, and he says that he had no greater joy than to know that his children, talking about the church, that they walked in truth. How can you walk in truth unless you really know the truth? You that have raised, you've raised children, you know, how many of you guys know it's in instilling truth, helping them understand truth, understand how to apply truth. It's more than just, you know, they wake up in the morning, you list off a few things, and they've got it, you know. How many times have you had to sit down with a child and like explain things and hey, are we on the same page here? What are you getting out of this conversation? What are you getting out of mom or dad and what we're sharing with you? And we as sheep, we're like those children. We really, in order to gain truth, in order to really understand truth, sometimes we need to be taught, and God has given to the church in Ephesians 4 those pastor teachers to help equip the saints for work of ministry and such. But how many times do we just, even for myself, I don't just read a scripture and get it. Sometimes I'll sit in a teaching setting like you do, and I don't get it. And so the design of this night, the reason we do this is with that in mind, that repetition being the mother of all learning, that we could sit down and kind of talk about and regurgitate those things that we're learning. And how many of you guys know the book of James has a lot to offer? There's a lot to learn in the book of James. Anybody tracking with the book of James, all right? So the five of you that raised your hands, I think we all know that, man, these are some really heavy Bible studies and heavy chapters, and to be able to just to sit down, take a deep breath, and sit down as family, and to open up God's Word in reference to what we've been learning on Sunday mornings, I think is very important. So that's what these nights are designed for, and we also believe that over the years, as God has grown our church from a surf shop Bible study, that relationship is huge. That building accountability and getting known and getting to know people is huge. And we live in a world today where that doesn't just happen on its own. Groups don't just come together in even spiritual settings and find that just naturally happens. There has to be opportunity for that to happen. There has to be desire for that to happen, and then opportunity for that to happen. And so if you call this place your home, great. Well, if you feel God's called you here, He's called you to a work that that really believes that we need to work on getting to know one another and be real with one another. And I can't think of a better setting to get to know someone than to share what we're both learning from God's Word. I think that's healthy in a marriage. I think it's healthy for a family. And it is absolutely healthy for God's family. So if you're new around here, you might say, wow, I've never been to a church that's done this before. It's painless. I think most people, they get a little intimidated. But once you realize, hey, there's some pretty nice people, we've trained them to be nice. Those that aren't nice, we don't let them come back on Wednesday nights, 242. So these are the nice ones that are left. But in all seriousness, we do take this as a very spiritual time. It's something God has put in our heart, and we just ask you to be open and to engage in the conversations. And I've got my notes. I've laid out, I've summarized chapter 2. And we have hosts at each tables that will walk you through, ask you questions. And whether you're saved or not, you know, it's a great time to learn the Word of God. So we're going to be talking about a couple of things. One, the theme of James, the whole, I think, focus of it is there was a problem in the church with their spiritual growth. There was a lack of spiritual maturity. And so this letter was inspired by God through James, who was the next in line of Jesus' brothers, grew up in the home of Jesus himself. But later on, after the resurrection, he would come to faith, and he would get the nod, the tap, and the Holy Spirit would say, you're going to pin down these words. As James, we are told from church history, was a man of prayer, and he prayed often for the church and had a burden for the church. And when he would come around and be used as a leader of the church, probably had no idea that this letter would be circulating a couple of thousand years later, and the inspiration of God through his heart and his pen would pierce people sitting in a room like this in the city of La Habra. But we've needed this. And so this whole focus of maturing faith, and so he walks through, and there's a couple of ways to approach the chapter. You can both of these chapters, you can say, well, he's maybe identifying some marks of spiritual maturity. What does spiritual maturity look like? Well, what's it look like when we face trials? What's it look like when we face temptation? We can go through it that way, and it's a great way to assess the book and let it fit. Also, we get into chapter 2, and he starts talking about faith. You might say chapter 1, there's a question. What does real spiritual maturity look like? There's some good examples there. But then you get into chapter 2, and you might shift a little bit of the focus, same goal in mind, spiritual maturity, but the question might change a little bit to now, what does true saving faith look like? And so he's going to hit the topic of partiality. He's going to use that, I believe, as an example. And then it bleeds over into that question. What does true saving faith really work like or look like? So I don't want to get ahead of my notes that I've given you. I want to leave the host with information and opportunity. I'll start preaching and I won't stop. I'll be in chapter 3 in a few minutes and it's not going to be fair. But do use this time. Introduce yourselves to one another. Enjoy the Word of God together. Enjoy one another and enjoy the Lord because He wants to work in our midst. So Father, we pray You would bless these conversations. And even as we'll be up here talking live to those watching online right now, we pray that You would be in our conversation and Lord, You would open up our hearts to receive from You, from Your Word. We thank You for what You've been doing in the teaching settings as we've been going through the book of James. And now more of a conversation, Lord, and there's still a lot to be taught, but now we can ask questions, and we pray that our hunger would be just aroused and that You would bring questions to the table that need to be asked. And man, we'd leave here just so blessed by the conversations that we're having in these table settings. So bless it, anoint it, and we'll give You credit for what's about to happen even now. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So go for it. You've got almost a whole hour, maybe 50 minutes, we'll say, and then we'll play some background music when we get going to transitioning into communion. So have fun. Okay. Am I on, Dave? Live? Okay. So our online audience that is live, we're going to ask you to turn your Bibles over to the book of James, chapter 2. And tonight, along with myself, we're going to have a couple of other people. And as they get their place up here, I will introduce them. And we're going to do a little bit of a sound check just to make sure that you can hear all of our mics, so I'm going to introduce my wife, Lori, of 30 years.
Hello.
Okay. And he's going to check these mics to make sure we're live online.
Yes. Hello, hello.
Hello. Dave, we're still on.
Yeah, he knows.
Okay.
No, go ahead.
Oh, gosh.
Very, very attentive people.
Yes, they are.
Okay, so as I said, I'm live online. Our sound booth is connecting these other mics right now, so be patient with us. I'm going to grab a music stand for my Bible.
Yes.
Just tap on it, Chris.
Yeah. I'll grab a couple.
All right, it's me and you, Lord. All right. Mine's just me and you.
Thank you. Thanks for being patient. How are we looking, sound booth? We got...
Good.
There we go.
Okay, you girls want to go and test your mics?
Yes, I do. It's all good.
Okay, so we're going to get right into this. Again, Francel, you can introduce yourselves over there. Francel and Sarah are on. Francel's a pastor on staff here. You're familiar if you watch us online with his beard. And this is his wife of 25 almost, yes. So, you probably heard my introduction if you were listening online, but, you know, if this looks a little strange, we're in a room filled with people. If you're just joining us, we, on the first Wednesday of the month, do a roundtable discussion on what we're learning on Sunday morning. So we're in the book of James. So again, if you haven't picked up your Bible and turned to the book of James, chapter 2, do so now, and we will walk right through that. As we get into chapter 2, there's a lot to go through, so we'll jump right into it, but just remember as you look at the book of James, he is desiring to see spiritual maturity in the church. That is something, as I say that, I always say to our church, something we as Christians should be desiring on a regular basis every day, and it's something that we might from time to time struggle with. And so James doesn't hit every issue, but he does bring up some classics that help us identify, quite possibly, if we are maturing in our faith or maybe possibly struggling in the area of maturing in our faith. But what I did in chapter 1 is I laid it out in almost a question form. What does spiritual maturity look like in the life of a believer when they face trials? And we talked about there that you know, trials, of course, are something that God allows. Trials are something that God uses. And obviously, as we look at that, he's showing how we should, if we are mature in the faith, respond to trials. We should look at them. A mature Christian will look at them, and they'll basically say, okay, I am to recognize this is, you know, this trial is from God, and it should mature me. It shouldn't shatter my faith or rock my faith. It should mature my faith. We can go into temptation. That's a good example as well in chapter 1. And he's talking about a mature Christian will persevere through temptation, not cave into temptation, because temptation leads to sin. And so we have these marks in chapter 1. A mature Christian will be known for being swift to hear, slow to speak, and slow to wrath. A mature Christian will be known by being a doer of God's word. An immature Christian hears the word of God, looks into the mirror ministry of God's word, and doesn't apply it. A mature Christian hears the word of God, looks into the mirror ministry of God's word. God's word says, this is wrong, this needs fixing. They line themselves up with that, they obey. They obey the word of God. That's a mature Christian. A mature Christian will control their tongue, he talks about in verse 26. A mature Christian will display a faith that shows interest in others. He talks about visiting widows and orphans, an extreme example of meeting the needs of the great, the more needy in society. So, coming into chapter 2, he begins to talk about partiality. And I would just say, follow the flow. It's the same flow. And I have a quote. I'll read it on partiality. I forgot who wrote it, but I rewrote it. And I'll claim it until I figure out who wrote that quote. But partiality showing partiality is an undue preference of others on account of what they have or do not have.
irrespective of who they are. It is the esteeming of another according to their place or their possessions. So why would James bring this up? I actually think it's a great example that everyone could look at and say, okay, wait a minute. Is he trying to say that a mature Christian will not show partiality and an immature Christian will show partiality? Absolutely. It's another indicator in our life. So I put some questions out there and we'll follow them through. But, I basically said, you know, to the group here, why don't you give some examples in the Bible or maybe even in the church of somebody or someone that shows partiality. And then I asked, what did Jesus say about or teach about partiality? And then, you know, just what is James saying in verse 1? So we'll throw that out to the group, and, you know, you can apply it any way you want. Maybe you got your own notes. I'll throw it out to Lori first. I'll put one of the girls on spot.
Okay.
Okay. So what, what does partiality look like in the church? Just an example of what we've seen maybe in our own lives, in our own church.
Well, it might be where people are making a partiality decision based on what they're wearing. Maybe if they're fancy clothes or designer clothes, one might be more friendly to them. And on the other hand, you might have a homeless person come. We do have some homeless that come, and, you know, not or showing partiality would We try not to do that here, but it may happen.
You know, I'm gonna apply it to some things that we were talking about today, Lance, because I really think about maturity, and until a mature Christian has walked through some things and has seen some things, and so I think that he's expressing here that even though you might think you know what's happening, like, let God be God. And if we show partiality, we're going to have the answers for everything, and we're going to judge even our experience. Hey, I know, like we talked about, if it looks like a duck, it is a duck. But we have no idea. There's many scriptures that tell us, I think about Judges, where it talks about Samson and his parents, and it said they had no idea what the Lord was doing. Mm-hmm. And you know, it's later on in James, it talks about, you know, don't say where you're going to go and what you're doing tomorrow, this, that, and the other, because just say as the Lord wills. So I think even in our judgment, we have to allow God to come into that equation. He might look like something, but God cares about the heart. Mm-hmm. And we need to guard our hearts from having judgment, because we have no idea who this person is, what they've been through. And we have no idea if God even wants to use a person in our lives to minister to us, regardless of how they look or their stature or their position. So
I think along with what Lori was saying, so many times our eyes can stop at the physical. You know, we can look at someone and say, oh yeah, that person looks like they're someone who can get it done, or because they look like they have money, they're affluent or whatever, and not underestimating, you know, God looks at the heart, and to go beyond that, what our physical eyes see. And so many times it can stop there. Can that person get me somewhere? You know, even that attitude can well up within the body. You know, like, oh, can that person get me, you know, through the channels or whatever that is, you know, just that outer appearance, or they look like they're important or whatever.
Yeah, and I think too, you know, I think as I was teaching this, I said even godly people can fall into this trap. Mm-hmm. You know, I gave the example of Samuel in 1 Samuel 16, where God's like, hey, Samuel, go to Bethlehem, and we need a new king. Saul's done. And he goes to Jesse's house, and hey, line up the boys. Mm-hmm. And, of course, you know, Jesse lines up his oldest, Eliab comes out, and right away Samuel's like, that's the one. And we know he was showing partiality because God calls him out on that. He's like, and I'm going to read it. It says, the Lord says to Samuel, no, do not look at his appearance or his physical stature, because that's what Samuel was looking at. Because I've refused him. The Lord does not see as man sees, for man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. Mm-hmm. And it's amazing. I wrote down in my notes what we will overlook in our prejudices. Mm. What we will look over in our prejudices, God usually doesn't. Something unique about that. So, in verse 1, my brethren, do not hold the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with partiality. And I've read that many times. I think I've taught on that many times. And I never sat down and asked myself, why did he phrase it that way? And again, James, the brother of Jesus, he's like, listen, I really know this guy. He never showed partiality. He never showed partiality. Later on in ministry, that's why they would label Jesus as a friend of sinners. He hangs out with the tax collectors, the publicans, he hangs out with sinners. And he was a friend of sinners, is what they said. That's what you say to someone that shows no partiality. And the way that he phrases this is, James is saying, I believe, starting off this conversation, going like, look, the standard is not the church. The standard is not what you think. It's not your judgment. The standard is Jesus. And when we hold the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, it's saying, hey, as a Christian, as you got to remember who you are, as you represent him, as you identify with him, you represent him. And to hold the faith of the Lord in the wrong way is to live our life in a way that misrepresents him. And so don't be showing partiality, is what he's saying in verse 1, because that misrepresents the character of God. It misrepresents Jesus. It misrepresents his word. So, Sarah, we'll let you read verses 2 through 4, and then we'll comment on those.
For if there should come into your assembly a man with gold rings and fine apparel, and there should also come in a poor man in filthy clothes, and you pay attention to the one wearing the fine clothes, and say to him, you sit here in a good place, and say to the poor man, you stand there or sit here at my footstool, have you not shown partiality among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts?
So you're laughing, Francel. Let's hear what you have to say about James's hypothetical.
It's a great hypothetical. It's wow. Like everything that the girls were just talking about, of like we could look at the outward appearance, and it is so. This is connected to verse 1. It really is, because Jesus never looked at people of what they could give. He never looked at that. And if we're looking at people in ways that way, hey, look, if that guy is rich, he could do something for me. Mm-hmm. He could do something for the church. We're not, like we said, it's connected to verse 1. We're not having the heart of God as we look at people. And we're not treating people the way Jesus would treat people. And, you know, I love, and I said, like, you know, I don't know if it's the right word, but I'm almost proud of what God has done here. When we have examples like Anthony, we have examples of just so many people in our church that we love, and we've invited them to the front. We've invited these people, and we're not looking for what they could give to us. We're looking how we could show love to them, and that is, it's a great lesson. You know, because it is hard. It is hard to see when someone walks on the property and they might stink a little bit. They might smell of alcohol. They might smell they haven't showered. And what do we do with that? You know, it's a heart check. God didn't ever, you know, look at those things. And like I said, that's why I think it's connected to verse 1, that we would show the heart of God to these people. So.
And it reveals our heart, how we can so quickly size people up. We immediately, again, we go to the physical, we size them up. What what can that person do for us? And it is, it, like you said, it's not showing the heart of God. So it is a quick heart check. Like, it is. We do it as humans. We fall. Yeah. We fail in that. But again, just praying and asking the Lord, give me your heart, because I'm sizing this person up.
Yeah, I think in the early church, the challenge, you know, you have all these cultures coming together. Obviously, James is writing primarily with the focus on converted Jews. And it would have been a diverse group, to say the least. You would have had some of the church that were wealthy, some that would have been poor, some that came out of cultures that this was accepted. This was taught. Even today, we have cultures where people are recognized by status. In India, we have the caste system, and if you're born into one caste system, you could be perceived. You were born into a very impoverished part of India, and if, you know, you grew up and you're the richest guy in India. For the rest of your life, your name and your identity to that impoverished area is carried with you, and they look down on you because of that status. In some churches, they teach that maybe people who give more are to be respected more. They put their names in plaques. They give them front seats. They give them badges of honor. They applaud them, and they feed that, and the rest of the church starts feeding that as well. And human nature that's left unchecked is going to like want that. Yeah. More applause, more recognition. And before long, you've got this incredible thing happening in the church that grieves the heart of God. So I like the way he concludes this in verse 4 as far as that first, those first three verses. Well, have you not shown partiality among yourselves when you do that? You know, giving preference to the guy who's got money and, you know, and not to the guy who doesn't. And become judges, that's the word you said, we're judging people with evil thoughts.
Yeah.
Why? It's evil when we begin to value somebody's soul based on what they have or do not have.
Yeah.
It's evil to think that a wealthy person is more beneficial to the church than a poor person. It's evil to look down on people that aren't educated and look up to people who are. It's just, he's like, that's evil. It's evil thoughts. And it can go to, wow, they're really educated, or maybe they're well-connected. They're known in the community. And wow, let's give preference to them. And in the social structure that we live in today, that's accepted. You know, a politician comes into town, and everybody wants to, you know, show favor to him, to gain favor from him. The same can happen in the church.
I think Pastor Chuck is a great example of not showing partiality. You know, when the hippies came around and they were drawn, they came and they sat on the floor, they didn't have shoes on, they were stinky, yet Pastor Chuck welcomed them. And I love his example. I love his heart for the lost, and he is just that modern day example for us at Calvary that, you know, we just say, come as you are. You know, you don't have to wear a tie. You don't have to wear a dress. You can just come as you are. And it's a good example.
And you know, this has always been with the church, and will always be at the church.
Yeah.
And in the early church, I gave the example of Peter. It was 10 years after the birthing of the church that the issue of Gentiles, can they be part of the church, can they be saved, actually would be dealt with. And, you know, 10 years later, they were showing incredible partiality to one demographic in society. And it wasn't until, you know, God has this vision unfold before Peter, and he sees the unclean animals on this rise, Peter, and eat. And he's like, no, I can't be doing that. And he says, hey, what I've called common, don't be calling unclean. And that led to, of course, a knock at the door, because God had been speaking up the beach to a man by the name of Cornelius regarding this very thing. He was a Roman centurion. He was a devout man, but not a saved man. God spoke to him at the same time he was like speaking to Peter and saying, send some of your guys to go get Peter. He's got a message for you. Peter comes all the way back to Caesarea from Joppa and walks into a Gentile's house, probably the first time in his whole life. Preaches the gospel. But while he was there, he says in Acts 10:34, he goes, in truth I perceive now that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, whoever fears him and works righteousness is accepted by him. So it's been around. And it was, I think James is like, this is a really immature trait in a person's heart. If this is what you're doing, it's a sign of spiritual immaturity.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, and yes, it's spiritual. It is not a sign of society maturing. Because society, even today, that happens. You know, I've told the story a couple different times of how I had to actually stop talking at my last job with my boss because he thought what I was saying, I'm making up stories. Like, how do you know this guy that's a janitor, but you know this business owner that has a private jet? Like, how does that, he didn't, in his head, didn't understand how that group associated together. And it's like, because there's no partiality. We don't think of those things. In church, I didn't even know the guy had a private jet. I didn't even know he was these things. We just don't, we don't look at each other that way. Right. But it's spiritual maturity when we look at, you know, you're watching a guy who is a business owner and he's parking cars. No one's looking, oh, well, he should be doing this. No, we don't look at it that way. And when we have that right, it is a sign of maturity. And I think about that. It's not, though, maturing in society. They see that as foreign. They don't understand why that happens. And we understand because, you know, it's almost like tonight, Acts 2:42, because there's no one different. We're going to have communion. And who doesn't need that? We talk about it, it's the equalizer of all of us. You know, yes, there might be the host that's handing it out, but he's going to accept it as well. And there's none of us that are above that.
Amen. Lori, why don't you read verse 5-7?
Okay. James 2:5-7. Listen, my beloved brethren, has God not chosen the poor of this world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom which he promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor man. Do not the rich oppress you and drag you into courts?
So, obviously, I think James approaches a lot of these topics very logically. And, you know, I think the way he says this, when you look back at verse 5, it's like very endearing. Hey, like almost to your kids. Listen, my beloved. You know, listen, kids, I love you. You got to get this. This is really important. And what he's trying to do is get them to really think through their value system. And you're placing value, more value on a person that has riches. And okay, that's just what you're doing when you're showing partiality. Well, God doesn't do that. God places greater value on saving faith, on faith, on the faith of a person. And so, number one, just think of that logically. Should we put value on something God's saying don't put value? And should we not be putting value on something God says we should be placing our value? Well, absolutely not. So he's getting them to think. I like that. It's like, really think through even who you're showing favoritism towards. And as I looked at this, I thought, you know, what he's trying to do is bring them back to where they should be really, the proper perspective would be, look, how are you going to see everybody the same in the church? By seeing them of equal value. Well, what part of everybody in the church do we look at in order for us to find equal value? Our faith. Our faith. Because that's what's important to God. That's how God looks past every earring in this room, every clothes, whatever, Giorgio Romano or
handbag.
Summer boards t-shirt. He looks past it all. And he's like, I see faith. That's what moves me. Mm-hmm. Your standard's gold. I pave streets in heaven with that stuff. It's just not a big deal to me. So, and then as he goes on, he, because this is a little bit more of a difficult part of the chapter, I think, so I'm just going to summarize it and we'll move on. Not that you girls aren't ready just to tackle this.
Thank you,
but
Max.
It is a little bit more of a challenge, I think. But then he's like, you know, you've dishonored the poor man even when you do that in verse 6. And then he's like, think logically about the richy yeah. people, the richy riches. Think practically, think logically, and think historically. Don't, when you really look at them and look at how they've treated Christians or treated Christianity, even today when we look at maybe society as a whole, that's what he's saying. He's not saying every single one, but generally speaking, don't they oppress you? And don't they talk really bad about Christianity? And you'd be like, yeah, I'm giving the best seat of the house to a demographic in society that does take advantage and oppress. And I just think it's he just leaves everybody, I think, at that point in the letter going, oh, man, what are we thinking? Well, it just kind of peels us all back. So, verses 8 and 9. Francelle, why don't you read that? Did you girls have any comments on that?
Sounds good.
Sounds good. Okay. I'll let Francelle, you can go. Where are we at?
8 and 9?
Yeah, you read 8 and 9, yeah.
Okay.
Actually, go all the way down to, what do I do in the notes here? Let's follow the notes. Because this
8 through 13.
8 through 13. Yeah, go ahead and read that.
Okay. If you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. You do well. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as a transgressor. For whoever shall keep the whole law and yet stumble in one point, he is guilty of all. For he who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not murder. Now, if you do not commit adultery, but you do murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so do as those who will be judged by the law of liberty. For judgment is without mercy to the one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment.
Anybody want to comment? Or do you want me to
peel? I love the last part.
Yes.
Mercy
okay, so
triumphs.
Come to the mercy.
I love the last part.
You
too.
Love the mercy. You're all like, mercy, mercy.
We're women. We're compassionate that way.
Yes.
I definitely want to show mercy because I want, and I have been shown mercy. So
yes.
I too want to dispense that mercy. And praise God, it triumphs over the judgment that I can place on people with my sizing it up, with my just judgmental heart at times.
And Francis is very grateful that you get this. It's wonderful.
I am very grateful.
He's a recipient of that.
I am a recipient of God's mercy through my wife. Absolutely.
So let's, we're family. We're sitting down with our family, and Dad brings up a really hard topic. Favoritism. We're a family.
Ooh,
yeah, we're all dealing with it. Mm. And he brings it back to the standard, which is Jesus. And now it's like, let's bring it back to the Word. What's the Word of God say about this? These are Jews. So to the Jews, the law was like huge. And they had a plethora of laws. But the law that he's talking about, the perfect law of liberty, and then he kind of describes it as the royal law, or, you know, what the Jews would know as the supreme law as far as Messianic Jews. Jesus would say in Matthew 22, 34 through, or 37 through 40, when he was asked what is the greatest commandment, he's like, well, the greatest one is love the Lord your God with all your mind, your body, and your soul, and with all your mind, and this is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. And so that's why he brings the law into the equation. the law reveals that it's sin. God mm-hmm. calls it sin. He talks about if we break one part of the law, we break the entire part of the law. You rip a part of a fabric, you rip the whole fabric is the idea. Why does he say that? Why does he say that? Why does he like, hey, you need to understand. You break one part of the law, you break them all. Why do you think he's saying that?
They were the law followers. To the T, they thought.
Do we have the tendency to kind of lay degrees? Well, mm-hmm. I've done this little thing, partiality, but I haven't done this real big.
Oh, yeah.
So we minimize certain sins mm-hmm. by saying we haven't done these other glaring sins. Mm-hmm. And he's like, no, hold on. Sin is sin.
Right.
Yeah.
Sin is sin.
Yeah.
And the mercy part that you girls want to talk about, you can jump on if you want to talk about that. Why does he bring up mercy right now? In the context of this.
Because we break the law.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because all fall short of the glory of God. Mm. And I think that we want mercy. And we also need to extend it to others. So we can't see ourselves as without sin.
He's mm-hmm. also bringing up the topic of judgment. Mm. Can't miss that. He's bringing up the topic of judgment. And for us, 1 Corinthians 3, we'll stand before the Bema Seat of Christ one day, and we're going to get an account on the motives behind what we did for him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm.
And I take this to say, okay, we're talking about how you see others and treat others, the motive of our heart.
Yeah. Mm.
You think they need mercy?
Mm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
So do you.
Yeah.
And my mercy extended to you will be proportioned by the mercy you show to others.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's a heavy way to look at that verse.
Yeah.
I think it fits.
I like the fact that he said, you shall love your neighbor as yourself in this portion, because I think here he's clarifying, I'm not talking bad about rich people. I look at, you know, if we look at all scripture, and that's what he's telling you, you might have a rich neighbor. And that doesn't mean you treat him bad, you love him. You love him. And, you know, there's other scriptures, I can't think of it right now, but all through Proverbs, it talks about, you know, the scales. And I can't judge even a rich person and say, there's nothing good in his heart because he's rich. Mm-hmm. And I love that, I believe that's what he's doing here when he talks about the neighbor. And I appreciate that, you know, because he's bringing them back to love.
Mm-hmm.
And he's almost saying, listen, I'm giving this as an example just because we understand it's a vivid example of the rich and the poor, because those are our hearts. But love.
Amen. My turn, verse 14. This was an additional study we had. So the first 13 verses we taught on one Sunday. Then we had a break and we came back to chapter 14 through the end of the chapter. But the focus shifts a little bit here from maybe drawing into question spiritual maturity and what does that look like. And now he kind of goes more into faith, saving faith.
Mm-hmm.
What does that look like? And there's a couple of really good questions, I think, that are drawn from this part of James 2. What does it profit, my brethren, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can faith save him?
Mm.
So faith, James is going to be talking about faith. And this is a very important topic to all of us. Faith is a huge part of our doctrine. We are saved by faith. We can't please God without faith. Sanctification is the result of all of this journey with God requires faith. So to understand faith as it relates to salvation, that's huge. So James here, he's just the way he says this, what does it profit, my brethren, if someone says, and that's the key word, says he has faith. So he's talking about the kind of faith that says. He's talking about a profession of faith in Christ, but does not have works. There's no works or evidence in their life to back up that profession. That's what he's just put out on the table. Hey, let's talk about the kind of faith that's just someone who professes faith in Christ, but there's no evidence in their life, no change in their life whatsoever to back up that claim. Let's talk about that. And then he gives another classic illustration. And I love that because it's very easy to follow. So why don't you read, Lori, verses 15 through 17.
Okay, it says, if a brother or sister is naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you says to them, depart in peace, be warmed and filled, but you do not give them the things in which are needed for the body, what does it profit? Thus, also, faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead.
So, I wrote two questions down for the host table. So, if you're home, here's the questions behind those two verses. Number one, what is the point James is trying to make in this illustration? Mm-hmm. Number two, can a saving faith exist without producing works, which is a display of saving faith? Mm-hmm. Those are good questions, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So, I'll let you guys make some comments on that.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the point James is trying to make is if we have a genuine saving faith, if we see a brother, sister in need, whether it be physical, spiritual, emotional, mental, you know, we are going to do everything in our power to assist that person and help them in that moment of need, you know, of course, with the aid of the Lord and his strength and his wisdom. And we're not just going to walk away and say, okay, well, hope it goes well for you, you know, like, hope you get warm, hope you get fed, or someone in spiritual need. Yeah, you know, I hope you find your way through the word on your own, you know, like instead of stopping and being disciplined enough, you know, and giving of your time. You know, a lot of times, you know, you can think of yourself in the grocery store busy and I got to get in, I got to get out. You know, this person looks like they need something. I don't have time, but do I stop because I have a genuine saving faith and go, you know what? It can wait 5 or 10 minutes. That person looks like they need something, you know? And again, physically, we can see the need when there's someone homeless, and you know, that's pretty obvious, but to actually ask the Lord before going into situations, you know, let me see the need, you know, let me see the plight in someone's life. And then when we pray that, are we going to follow through and be willing to help people, you know, and not just walk away? Yeah. Wish you well.
I think, you know, as you look at it, it's almost like in chapter one, he talks about the mirror, you know, and it's almost sarcastic. It's almost humorous as he's giving these illustrations, because we understand we're not going to do these things. It doesn't make sense that we, like, and he's saying, look, that's how ridiculous this is. You have faith, and just by me saying something is going to change something. You know, that's not how faith works. I think that's the understanding, is like, of course we're going to do something. If we have faith, of course we're going to, man, I'm going to help someone. I'm going to give someone. I'm not going to think, I'm not going to give that guy a bottle of water. That is, if we have faith, it is ridiculous to think that we wouldn't do these things.
I think Jesus was a great example of this when the thousands were following him, and the disciples were practically thinking, boy, we can't feed all these people. Let's just send them home now. But Jesus was moved with compassion, and he said, what do we have? And then he did the miraculous. He used what he had. The disciples were able to see his faith, his compassion, his provision, and he multiplied the loaves and the fish. And I think it's just a great example of how Jesus was moved with compassion based with the people that were following him and in great need.
I think it's important to, when I was building this, I really thought through, okay, why is he using this example? And I think that we can all say, well, yeah, There's got to be evidence and that Jesus is a model of that, and we understand that as well. But you might be out there and, you know, to kind of lay this out biblically, like just a good biblical basis behind this illustration. To help a person is an expression of love. Mm. And what I gave in that study, I'm going to give you some scriptures, but write down Romans 5:5. Number one, Paul's saying that love is an identifying mark of saving faith. Mm. The love of God has been poured out, talking to believers, the love of God has been poured out within our hearts through the Holy Spirit. We know in Galatians 5, the top of the list of the fruit of the Spirit. So when God puts spiritual life in us, there's like a tomato plant. How do you know that it is alive? There's a tomato. So there's fruit. The top of the list of spiritual fruit is love. Evidence. That evidences saving faith. But that love is not just placed in us, the love of God. That love is also designed, in the DNA of God's love, is designed to be expressed towards others. 1 John 3:14, we know that we have passed from death into life, spiritual death into spiritual life, because we love the brethren. Jesus said that this act of love, displaying love, is an identifying mark that we are truly His, and we're followers of His. Another great scripture to write down, John 13:35, by this all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. So you just draw the conclusion. Thus, we follow that through. It's an identifying mark upon our life. It's an identifying mark that we are His. It's an identifying mark that there's spiritual life, true saving faith. Thus, John would say in 1 John 3:17-18, if anyone has material possessions and sees his brother in need, but doesn't have pity on him, how can the love of God be in him? Don't be, dear children, let us not love in with words and tongue alone, but in actions and in truth. So saving faith is displayed by evidence. Evidence, the greatest evidence is love. And God's love is an active love that will show itself in reaching out to others, just like we see James talking about here.
Amen.
So, thus, verse 17, also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. We know that we are saved by faith. Ephesians 2:8-9, for by grace you are saved through faith. We know that. It's not of works. But it was Calvin that said, it is faith alone that justifies, but faith that justifies is never alone. There's always evidence to the life of Jesus Christ working through the people that he says. Matthew 5:17, another great verse. Jesus says we should so live our lives that the world may see our good works and glorify our Father, which is in heaven. 1 John 5:12, he that has the Son has life. He that doesn't have the Son doesn't have life. And then I had a Warren Wiersbe quote, and I'll let you guys take it from here, where it says, dead faith is not saving faith. Dead faith is counterfeit faith, and it lulls the person into a false confidence of eternal life. So, verse 18. Sarah, you want to read that?
Sure thing. Verse 18. But someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith without your works, and I will show you my faith by my works.
I think 19 is
right. Oh, 19, sorry. You believe that there is one God, you do well. Even the demons believe and tremble.
What are we learning there, girls?
That the demons have faith. Even the demons have faith.
There will be evidence of your faith it's not just enough, for example, to go down to an altar call, maybe at the Harvest Crusade. You're emotionally moved. But then you leave that arena and you just continue to live your life against God's word. And James here is saying there should be a change. There should be that evidence. I know sometimes on a practical note, you might be, you know, maybe at school or at work or at the gym or something, and you know someone is a Christian. However, they're cussing and they're living their life in a crazy way, and it's just confusing when you meet them. And it shouldn't be so. Mm-hmm. It's like they're saying one thing, but their lives don't reflect that. Mm-hmm. And that's dead faith. Mm-hmm. And some would wonder, really, were they ever truly saved? Mm-hmm. And that's a question that you can explore with them. You can challenge them if mm-hmm. the Lord would so lead. But we need to make sure that our words, that our life behind our words are the same. Mm-hmm. We're not one way in one setting and a different in another. Mm-hmm. Kind of like a chameleon, you know, that lizard that changes color based on its environment. Mm-hmm. We need to definitely make sure that who we say we are, mm-hmm. our life lives up to it. Not that we're perfect, you know, because we will make mistakes. We will need that mercy that we talked about in earlier verse in James. But it's just living a life according to God's word. Mm. That's true saving faith.
Mm. Yeah. I think there's two categories he's addressing here. There's that one category Lori talked about, the person that's like, hey, man, I made the profession. Mm. So James is almost assuming that person's out there. You're going to come and say, hey, you focus on the work side of it. I focus on the profession side of it. Look, I profess Jesus as my Savior. Mm. Done deal. And James is like, no, you can't play that hand. Mm. We got to see some evidence here.
Yeah.
It's faith plus works. As I said, it's almost like you're not going to be flying an airplane without its wings. They're inseparable. And then he gives the illustration of demons, and I think that what he's doing there is it's very practical, because mm-hmm. there's those people out there mm-hmm. that go, I know God, mm-hmm. and they've got all this head knowledge, mm. and they know, you know, more about God than maybe we do, mm. but as demons, they've never received the word of God. It's in their head, mm-hmm. but they've never, as James said earlier, received with meekness the implanted word of God, which mm-hmm. is able to save your souls, and that's a work of the Spirit. It's mm-hmm. submitting to the Word of God and the Son of God. Mm. And that's what demons have never done. And that's what he's saying. Some of you are making these claims mm. that you've made a profession, that you got all this knowledge of God, but you're not obeying the Word of God and the Son of God.
Yeah.
And there's fruit in your life if you are, and there's no fruit in your life, no works in your life if you're not. And just very cut and dry there.
Yeah. You know, I worked with a guy years ago when I was first a believer, and this guy knew his Word. And I remember one of my coworkers and I were sharing with him, and he said, and he knew end times better than we did. And he said he believed it. He said, I see the signs. And it was so foreign to me, but he said, but I'm not following that. He said, I want to live the life the way I want to live.
Sure.
And it was so, but this scripture came mm-hmm. alive to me at that mm-hmm. point. I was like, okay, like, we have to choose. And he's choosing not to live this way. We have to choose to live in a way that would honor and glorify the Lord. To show, because he believed, and he himself said, he told me, I'd rather go to hell than live the way God would want me to live. That's what he said to him. And it was very foreign to me. But this is what he's saying. Like mm-hmm. that's an honest person saying that, you know, but a lot of times there are people that are not honest and say, all I need to do is believe. And that's my e-ticket into heaven, you know,
it's like a farmer. I'm just going to buy a field and it ends there. You know, you got to plow, you got to plant, you got to water, you know, and so the inner workings of our heart with our faith, it's going to play out in our works.
Well, I'm gonna summarize the end because we're out of time. See how fast time goes up? It's like we're here and it's gone. So thank you, Lori, for coming, and Sarah for joining us as well.
Thank you.
But let me summarize this. He's going to give two examples, one of a Jew, one of a Gentile, that illustrate his point. And both are in the Hall of Faith in Hebrews chapter 11, and both Abraham and then Rahab. And both of them, without getting into the story, heard the word of God, believed the word of God, but then they acted on the word of God. And that's the point he's making. And because they acted on the word of God, as he would say in reference to Abraham, you see then in verse 24 that a man is justified or saved there by works and not by faith alone. There's going to be the works, the evidence that marks that. So to summarize this, we are not saved by works. We don't earn our salvation. We are saved by faith in Christ. What's the evidence of that? Works. Works. That life of Christ will live out and produce fruit. We will line up our life with his word, and it will have a look to it. Lastly, he'll say, for as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. So as the body needs a spirit to communicate life, that there's real life, so faith needs works, evidence, to communicate that there is real life there. So, thank you guys. Thank you. If you are out there, you can. We're going to take communion. You can get some bread and some juice in your house, and we're going to lead the church in that. The bread representing, again, the body of Jesus that was broken for us, and the juice, the cup, representing his blood that was shed. So we're going to get our guitar up here and start playing some background music and partake of communion. If you don't know Jesus, you're out there listening as well, I would encourage you to, the word says, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And you've heard now the danger of not being right, what true saving faith is, putting faith in Jesus. So it'd be that time maybe tonight or right now. Just in Romans it says we've all sinned and fall short of the glory of God, to confess that to God, that you're a sinner. Then he would say that the wages of sin is death, separation from God, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And so it would be a great time even now to confess your sinner to him and ask Jesus, who died on the cross and was buried and rose from the dead, for you to come into your life and really pray that and mean that. And if you do, thank him for saving you and ask him to give you a hunger for his word and get into his word. And we would encourage you, if you don't come here, to find a good Bible teaching church in your community. If you need help with that, or you have any questions for us at all, feel free to call the church office between 9 to 5, Monday through Friday, and we would love to get back to you. Or email us directly at
info@calvarylahabra.org.
All of our Bible studies are online for free. You can go to Calvary Chapel La Habra or whatever online. We have an app. What's our app again?
CCLH.
CCLH?
Yeah, in the App Store.
In your app search engine. All the Bible studies are there, video format, audio format. Love to answer any questions. We love you. God bless you. Shift gears here, and I'm going to ask the host of each table to pray over your communion and dish out the. Why don't you go ahead and dish out the bread and the cup? And we have an online audience listening too. You want to just wave to them, that camera, wave to Dave back there, and yeah, so they've been hanging out with us here, and
Just take a couple minutes. And the bread, as we know, represents Jesus' body that was broken for us, and the cup represents his blood that was shed. And so we'll let you pray and take that together. So, Father, we thank you for, these tender moments. Thank you for family, for body life, for being in our midst, for being alive and well in our hearts and in our relationships in this room. And we love you. We pray that this night would impress you and bless you and minister to you as well. It's so good just to go through your word. It just makes the world look wacko and following you so right. And we thank you for that. And we look forward to your return. Thank you for your sacrifice, for loving us all. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. All right, why don't you all stand? We'll call this part of the night over. couple things. You know, we have a, you guys like worship around here? Yeah, good worship, yeah. And a couple weeks ago, we did a, weeks back, we did a little bit of a different venue here. I did a study on the Bride of Christ. You guys remember that? And then we had extended time for communion, and we called out specific opportunities to come up for prayer, and we were really blessed at the response that day. So this Sunday, we're going to be taking communion again, but for you that do get here during first service and even second service, we're going to start worship early. So we start at 9 and 11, but if you get here at half an hour early, we do this every week, but on Communion Sunday, a lot more people come. But if you just like, man, I'd like to hang out in the presence of God for a bit longer, then just show up at 8:30, and we'll be in here doing worship. And then communion again, we're going to have people up front, and we're going to invite people who need prayer to come up for communion first. And then those that, I guess we all need prayer, but those that are like, I don't need it today, they come up afterwards. It's kind of weird, huh? So that's Sunday. So be praying about that. And maybe there's somebody you know that's just needing prayer. They're not well. I know a lot of people, you bring your friends with, they just found out some bad news regarding their health, and we anoint them with oil and pray over them. Or maybe someone's marriage is just not doing good, and encourage them. Say, hey, this Sunday we have a time, an extended amount of time, and we're going to go through James 3 and all that, but just a little more time for that, just to come up front and to spend time in the presence of the Lord. So that's a Sunday. So pass the word. And then outside, our homeschool, they're going on a senior trip and whatnot, so if you didn't get their, what is it, meatball sandwiches on the way in, they got you on the way out with dessert. I don't know. We're just going to be not healthy. But we'll start up an exercise class next week or something. I don't know. But it's time to go. We're going to play some music, but you're free to go and bless them on the way out, the homeschool. And we love you guys. Thanks for coming out.
Shaping and moved
What's
up to Greg Rippey.
If I remember him. That sounds familiar.
Yeah, he's a Valley View guy. Came over here.
Oh, what a trip.